تفسدوا في الأرض؟ قالوا إنما نحن مصلحون. ألا إنهم هم المفسدون ولكن لا يشعرون. وإذا قيل لهم آمنوا كما آمن الناس قالوا أنؤمن كما آمن السفهاء؟ ألا إنهم هم السفهاء ولكن لا يعلمون. وإذا لقوا الذين آمنوا قالوا آمنا، وإذا خلوا إلى شياطينهم قالوا إنا معكم إنما نحن مستهزئون. الله يستهزئ بهم ويمدهم في طغيانهم يعمهون. أولئك الذين اشتروا الضلالة بالهدى فما ربحت تجارتهم وما كانوا مهتدين. صدق الله العلي العظيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. السلام عليك يا وارث آدم صفوة الله. السلام عليك يا وارث نوح نبي الله. السلام عليك يا وارث إبراهيم خليل الله. السلام عليك يا وارث موسى كليم الله. السلام عليك يا وارث عيسى روح الله. السلام عليك يا وارث محمد حبيب الله. السلام عليك يا وارث أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام. السلام عليك يا ابن محمد المصطفى. السلام عليك يا ابن علي المرتضى. السلام عليك يا ابن فاطمة الزهراء. السلام عليك يا ابن خديجة الكبرى. السلام عليك يا ثار الله وابن ثاره والوتر الموتور. أشهد أنك قد أقمت الصلاة وآتيت الزكاة وأمرت بالمعروف ونهيت عن المنكر وأطعت الله ورسوله حتى أتاك اليقين. فلعن الله أمة قتلتك، ولعن الله أمة ظلمتك، ولعن الله أمة سمعت بذلك فرضيت به. يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله، أشهد أنك كنت نورا في الأصلاب الشامخة والأرحام المطهرة، لم تنجسك الجاهلية بأنجاسها، ولم تلبسك من مدلهمات ثيابها. وأشهد أنك من دعائم الدين وأركان المؤمنين. وأشهد أنك الإمام البر التقي الرضي الزكي الهادي المهدي. وأشهد أن الأئمة من ولدك كلمة التقوى وأعلام الهدى والعروة الوثقى والحجة على أهل الدنيا. وأشهد الله وملائكة وملائكته وأنبياءه ورسله أني بكم مؤمن وبي بكم موقن بشرائع ديني وقواتيم عملي وقلبي لقلبكم سلم وأمري لأمركم متبع صلوات الله عليكم وعلى أرواحكم وعلى أجسادكم وعلى أجسامكم وعلى شاهدكم وعلى غائبكم وعلى ظاهركم وعلى باطنكم بأبي أنت وأمي يا ابن رسول الله بأبي أنت وأمي يا أبا عبد الله لقد عظمت الرزية وجلت المصيبة بك علينا وعلى جميع أهل السماوات والأرض فلعن الله أمة أسرجت وألجمت وتهيأت لقتالك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله قصدت حرمك وأتيت إلى مشهدك أسأل الله بالشأن الذي لك عنده وبالمحل الذي لك لديه أن يصلي على محمد وآل محمد وأن يجعلني معكم في الدنيا والآخرة.
Imam Rida alayhi salam said to Rayyan ibn Shabib, O son of Shabib, if you have to cry over something, then do so Abu Hussein ibn Ali alayhi salam. For surely he was slaughtered in a manner in which a ram is slaughtered. Dear brothers and sisters, we ask you to follow a few simple rules. Please do not stand outside at the front of the mosque. Please come inside, or if you want to be outside, just hang around the space next to the mosque. Please turn off your phone during the lecture. Do not distract others as well. Children 14 and under, they have to be supervised by an adult at all times. Kids or boys from 6 to 12 can join the classes upstairs. These classes are starting now, so these kids can go up now. The program will be as follows. A lecture by Hajj Firas Naji, then Masaib by Hajj Muhammad Naqi, and an Arabic lecture by Sheikh Sumyani. And then let me out afterwards. Please welcome Hajj Firas Naji with your loudest salawat.
أفلح من صلى على محمد وآل محمد. Welcome back to the second night of the historical context of Ashura. This is the theme over the next, well, for four nights, so one night already gone, so we have the the three nights, inshallah, where we talk about how things developed over the history, over the time, and led to the event of Ashura. As you see, last night we talked about the part one, which is the events during the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam, and we touched on many important points, and we finished with the if you remember, the Raziyat Yawm al-Khamis, or the tragedy of Thursday. And we said the Prophet was prevented by the Sahaba, by the, you know, disagreement among the Sahaba, from writing that document for them, which will prevent them from going astray. لَن تَظَلُّوا بَعْدِي أَبَدًا. So, and we discussed, said one of the arguments that they say when Umar or whoever said this in the Nabiya la yahjur, or لَقَدْ غَلَبَ عَلَيْهِ الْوَجَعِ, he was just too tired for this. They say because the Prophet was too tired and they were worried about him. But the one key point, maybe I forgot to mention last night, maybe I did mention it, I can't remember, terrible memory, but what I said was we need to pay attention to the first part of this word, what he says, حَسْبُنَا كِتَابُ اللَّهِ. Don't worry about whatever he said after, okay? He said one word before, حَسْبُنَا كِتَابُ اللَّهِ. كِتَابُ اللَّهِ, the book of Allah, is sufficient for us. Why did he say that? Why? Because he knew what's going to come, it's not against, according to his, we said, what's the term that we used yesterday? Against his grain, okay? Anyway, inshallah, you can research this further on your own. So we'll get started tonight, inshallah. So we have discussed the events during the lifetime of the Prophet. Tonight we will discuss what happened after the death of the Prophet. And tomorrow we will discuss what happened during the Khulafa, and especially Khalifa Uthman and Imam Ali. And then in night four, which is Friday night, inshallah, we'll talk about the events during Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein. So tonight, the events after the departure of the Prophet. So this is what I'm going to be talking about tonight, inshallah. We will talk about what happened in Saqifa. And again, very brief. I cannot go into further details, but very brief, I will give you a quick overview of what happened in Saqifa. And did Imam Ali pay allegiance to Abu Bakr? هل بايع الإمام علي أبو بكر or no? And why? And was there a real consultation, shura, the term used, shura? Was it really shura practiced during the first khalifa, second khalifa, third khalifa? Was it really shura? We'll go through it, inshallah. And we will try to answer this very key, important question. If Imam Ali alayhi salam had all these characters in the Quran, in the hadith, why wasn't he supported to become the leader, the imam? Even though he was the imam, but I mean the khalifa, I should say. Okay? Why didn't the sahaba vote for him? Why? There must be a reason why. Inshallah, we'll go through it. Now, what happened in Saqifa? First thing, I have to explain the word Saqifa. So those from Iraqi background, they know Saqifa. Yeah? Saqifa is like a pergola. It's like a roofed area. Okay, so they used to use it back then when it's hot during the midday. They have this palm tree and they put something there like a roof just to protect them from the heat of the sun so they can discuss the issues. The Al-Ansar, or the term Al-Ansar is used for the original inhabitants of Medina. They called Al-Ansar. Al-Muhajirin, it's the term used for immigrants, the people who migrated from Mecca to Medina. Okay, so Al-Ansar, whatever things that they had before, whatever things they want to decide on, they don't take decision unless they take on shura between them. They have this process. They sit down, they consult one another, and they agree on one thing. And then they all do it. And the Quran praises them for that. And he says, وَأَمْرُهُمْ شُورَى بَيْنَهُمْ. أمرهم refers to the Ansar. That's what they used to do. Everything they do, they take on Shura. Now what our Sunni brothers, with all respect, they take this ayah out of context, read it in its context, please. Okay, I have no time to go through it now, but please read it in its context. وَأَمْرُهُمْ شُورَى بَيْنُهُمْ. They take it out of context and apply it to the leadership of Islam, to the imamah, to the khilafah. They say, Allah says, أَمْرُهُمْ شُورَى, الْأَمِيرُ, or the governor, should be selected by consultation. Okay, we will discuss this inshallah. But that's not what it's referring to. And this saqifa, it's actually not inside the Medina, it's on the outskirts of Medina, outside. And it belongs to Ansar. Whenever they used to consult one another, they sit down there and they talk about it. What happened is, Al-Ansar, when they heard the Prophet died, they sat down, they had their own private meeting in the saqifa. So they sat down and then they discussed between themselves. Okay, the Prophet died. What are we going to do? Who's going to lead? Some they say, well, we'll have to go with Imam Ali because that's what the Prophet said. And they say, some they say, okay, but there are others who doesn't want this to happen. Anyway, while this was happening, there were Al-Muhajireen and other groups of people. They were washing the body of the Prophet. Inshallah, we'll go through it. So, what is this? I did explain this. Okay. So this is the claim that they Ansar, because what happened is, I skipped this. Abu Bakr was washing the body of the Prophet together with Imam Ali and other Sahaba, like Ibn Abbas, and they were there. But Umar was outside, wasn't there inside, was somewhere else. But then Umar was tipped that the Ansar are gathering and they're making consultation in the Saqifah. It's taking place there. So that's about, they're discussing the issue of Khilafah. So that's why he said, okay, he went to where the Prophet was getting ready and, you know, the getting washed and shrouded. He sent a messenger to Abu Bakr inside. Come out, I want to see you. And then Abu Bakr sent to him, I'm busy, what do you want? And he sent him back, said, look, come out, it's important, you must come now. So he left. When he came, he talked to him, he explained to him what happened. They both went very fast towards As-Saqifah. On the way, they met Abu Ubaidah. Okay? Abu Ubaidah, and then all three went to As-Saqifah. And they imposed themselves on that meeting. They were not invited. They just imposed themselves. And then what happened after that? I have to summarize it. It's a very long story, but I have to summarize it. There's a lot of important details there, but I can't go through it now. And inshallah, in the future. The Ansar, they laid this claim. They say, look, we should be taking the Khilafah because it is our city. And we supported the Prophet. نَحْنُ آوَيْنَا وَنَصَرْنَا. We have gave the Prophet this safe haven, and we supported the Prophet. So it's actually our right to elect the leader from our side. But then Al-Muhajirin says, no. We are the tribe of the Prophet. We are from his tribe. We are from Mecca. He is from Mecca. He is from Quraysh. We are from Quraysh. We should be taking that role, not you, because we are the closest in kinship to him. Now, they both have ignored this very important two facts, where Imam Ali was the greatest supporter to the Prophet, and Imam Ali was the closest in his kinship. So that's why you hear the Imam says, احتجوا بالشجرة وأضاعوا الثمرة. They used the tree, but to make the reason, but then they forgot about the fruit. So there were two gatherings here. I'm not sure if you can see the slide. There was this gathering at the Saqifah, and there was Al-Ansar. The historians tell us there were definitely less than 100. I don't know how much, the number, between 60 to 80, but definitely less than 100. And the Muhajirin, we're only three. But guess what? The Muhajirin end up winning this argument. We're going to go through it, inshallah. And where the body of the Prophet was laid and getting washed and getting ready for burial, there was Imam Ali, of course, there, and Ibn Abbas and other Sahaba doing this. Here comes the question. If you remember last night, when we went about talking about how the Prophet wanted the Sahaba to join the campaign of Usama, Jaysh Usama, yeah? لَعَنَ اللَّهُ مَنْ تَخَلَّفَ عَنْهُ. They want them to join that campaign, but they refused. What was their excuse? Do you remember? What was their excuse? Ahsan. We love the Prophet dearly, and we worried about his medical condition. We want to stay with him. We want to have a close watch of him. Where are they now? These people who made that claim and disobeyed, clearly disobeyed Allah and disobeyed the Prophet, where are they now? You know where are they? They're in Saqifah, those people. In Saqifah. This, arguing about the leadership, about the Khilafah. And the body was there of the Prophet. They left it behind. So that answers their question. They claimed they were concerned about the Prophet. So, inside Saqifah, the historian tells us there was some physical violence. Quarreling, arguing, even shouting one another, calling others' names. And this is from Al-Tabari, Tariq Al-Tabari, or Tafsir Al-Tabari. He is a Sunni historian. And he said there was a state of confusion, argument, tribalism, brawl inside Saqifah, intimidation, and even physical violence. So some of the Ansar, while they said, okay, we will not pay allegiance except to Imam Ali, because they heard it from the Prophet. And others, they said no, and they kept on arguing about this point. But then the reason that, inshallah, we'll go through it. But when this physical violence happened, Umar had a physical fight with Sa'd ibn Ibadah and Al-Habbab ibn al-Mundhir. And they are both leaders of Al-Khazraj. Sa'd ibn Ibadah was an old man. And how do we know about this? Because the Al-Tabari tells us, some of the Ansar, they said, don't hurt Sa'd ibn Ibadah, as he refused to pay allegiance to Abu Bakr. And Umar said, اقتلوه قتله الله. Kill him, may Allah kill him. And just, I'll put this in two brackets. Sa'd ibn Ibadah was killed, was assassinated with an arrow 3 years after this event. Now, the reason these Muhajirin end up winning this argument is, I don't know how to describe it. There's a lot of details, but I'll just give you very quick points. The claim Abu Bakr made, and he was an eloquent speaker, the claim he made, he touched on a nerve. All Arabs back then used to respect that thing, and they used to abide by it, and used to do and practice it all the time. One word, what is it? Tribalism. This is from this tribe, it must stay in that tribe. If you have a tribal leader, and if he dies, who takes over next? The older son, or the cousin, or the uncle. That's it, it stays within that tribe, within that family. You have no right to take it from them. That's their mentality back then. So he was pressing hard on this nerve. That's why they end up winning. Okay? Inshallah, we'll go through it into more detail in the future. And we'll explain it, how he tricked them. Okay? And he said to them, he promised them, he gave them a lot of promises where he said, you are al-ansar, antum awaitum wa nasartum wa la nansa dalik. And he said, al-umara wa minkum al-wuzara. We have the Amir or the Khalifa from us, from the Muhajirin, and you will have the ministers, and we will consult you. We will never do anything without your consultation. But that didn't happen. And I have a proof of that. Everything I say here is not my words, like I said. They are the work of our ulama. I'm only presenting this. Everything we Shia claim, we have proof for it. We have proof. Everything is authentic. From Sunni sources, not from our sources. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Now, Al-Quran have predicted this. This will happen earlier. What it says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلًا قَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا وَسَيَجْزِي اللَّهُ الشَّاكِرِينَ. He says, Muhammad is not more than a messenger. And if he was killed or died, do you go back on your heels? Meaning you disbelieve in the message of Allah? And that's what happened. And whoever does this, whoever turns, it does not affect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was revealed in Surah in Ma'rakat Uhud. Now, did Imam Ali pay allegiance to Abu Bakr? Yes or no? The famous opinion of the Shia, the majority, they say yes, he did after some time. They say 6 months. He raised the flag and he said, this is not a legitimate khilafah. But when things got to a stage where there was an internal war was about to break out within Islam, he was worried about Islam more than about himself. That's why he had to pay allegiance and move with the Muslims just to make sure the Islam will stay the same. Otherwise, Islam would have been destroyed. No more Islam. So he initially said, he refused to pay allegiance, but then he was forced to do it. Now, how to do this? I will explain this. Abu Sufyan, la'natullahi alayh, when he heard this, he said, okay, this is a good opportunity for me now to go in and start causing trouble. So he went to Medina and he asked, أين الأذلان علي والعباس? He was calling Imam Ali and Ibn Abbas. Okay? And where are they? Why does this happen to you? They take the Khilafah from you, it should be to you. That's obviously not his intention. So Imam Ali kicked him out of his house. He said, just leave us alone. This is an internal problem between Muslims, we can fix it. You want to bring Hubal and put it back again on the Kaaba? Hubal is one of the idols they used to worship in the Jahiliyyah. So just to keep the peace and among the Muslims, Imam Ali had to, no choice other than to pay allegiance. Now, this is the claim that made. There was a democratic election, or the word consultation, or the Arabic word for it is shura. In reality, there is no shura. The three Khulafa, Abu Bakr, Umar, and Uthman, they were selected in a completely different ways. And we'll go through it, inshallah. There was no system back then. They just usurped the Khilafah. I'm sorry that we may, maybe this, I'm not sure what's the audience, but there might be some Sunnis here. I learned, but this is nothing against you personally or against your belief. This is just to lay out the facts in front of you, and we have the sources, and you are free to review this. If you have any questions, you can ask us. But honestly, we're not here to go. We don't hear us going and knocking on your doors and arguing about this. No, but I want you to, because this is Muharram, is the prime time for Shia gathering. Am I right? So we have to use this time, according to Imam Khomeini will, and his advice, he said, use this time is the best time. When the Shia gathered, deliver the most important messages around this time in Muharram. So that's why I thought we have to go through history. At least once in our lifetime, we hear it. Okay, so Abu Bakr was not democratically elected during Saqifah. Because what happened in Saqifah, when he used this argument, he ended up winning. And not because they were, the Ansar were intimidated, but because they were not outnumbered. But this gives you an idea of this tribalism and how they used to practice it a lot. And when this, when as soon as they made the claim about this, they could not argue anymore. What they said, okay, minna amir wa minkum amir. They gave way during the discussion. They said, okay, we agree. One khalifa from you and one leader from us, and they both will govern. They said, no. Because he saw them getting weak. So he said, no. Minna al-umara wa minkum al-wuzara. We have the leaders, but you have the ministers. And no ministers worship nothing. Okay, so because they end up winning, it was like it was described by the words of Umar. Okay, there was no real consultation, because when what happened when he said this, Umar shake hand with him, he paid allegiance. I pay allegiance to you. You are my Khalifa. And then Abu Ubaidah after him, one of the leaders of Al Khazraj. I think it was Al-Habbab ibn al-Mundhir. He also paid allegiance. He was persuaded. He didn't want to argue more. And then the rest of the 100 or less than 100, they all just, you know, just poor people. They're sitting down. You know, when you have a lot of gathering, we all experience this. When we sit down and you have like a sheikh there or a leader sitting down and talking, would you talk? You just listen. Whatever your leader, your, there used to be like a tribes, you know. The leader of the tribe, the head of the tribe, says something, you just follow. So he shook hand. He had probably 50 people behind him. They all shook hand. The rest said, okay, we don't want to be left out. So they do it. It's just a slip. That's exactly what Umar described in his words. Towards the end of his life, Umar ibn Khattab said in a public lecture, the allegiance of Abu Bakr was a slip that occurred, and God saved the people from its evil. كانت بيعة أبي بكر فلتة وقال الله المسلمين شرها. Why فلتة? Because it could have broken a war there. It very easily. But things happened. It was a slip. Honestly, it was a slip. And whoever acts in that way of choosing a Khalifa, kill him, he says. Why? If it was a good shura, why would you not agree with it? So it's not shura. If it's shura according to the Quran, you would not have said this. Now, someone asked me for the source. It's too small to see, but if you want a copy of the slides, contact us here. We'll give it to you. Al-Tabari, and there's more. Al-Dahabi, all of these sources are at the bottom. Okay? This is not from Shia source, Sunni sources. Now, when Abu Bakr became the Khalifa, 2 years later, when he was dying, he directly appointed Umar. He said, if I die, your Khalifa will be Umar. Directly appointing. Nas, ta'een. So when we say Allah has appointed Ahlul Bayt, they say, no, you can't do that. But Allah. But when Abu Bakr appoint directly Umar, they say, yeah, that's fine. It's Abu Bakr. He is ma'soom. He's allowed to do that. He has the right. Again, a source, Al-Tabari, and you understand, and these are the pages, it might be different in the copies, but this is the one that we looked at. So it was, again, no consultation, no shura. Okay, what about, so that's why when Imam Ali saw Umar, who was so enthusiastic about doing this, and pushing for this, preparing for Abu Bakr to do it, Imam Ali noticed it and he said, أحلب يا عمر حلبا لك شطره. Yeah? اشتد له اليوم أمره ليرده عليك غدا. He said, milking, as if you're milking a milk or cow, that you will have a share of it. Because you will have a share of it, you know, definitely. Whatever you do, you're preparing for yourself. Abu Bakr, he was an old man. He would not last long. And then he would, you know, pay you back for this favor. And he did, exactly. And the source of this is Sharh Nahj al-Balagha li Ibn Abi al-Hadid al-Mu'tazili, a Sunni scholar. Okay, what happened to the third Khalifa, Uthman? This is a funny one. Umar, on his deathbed, he appointed 6 muhajirin. He invented his own way. There was no shura. But the way that he made it, he didn't want the similar way to Abu Bakr because that was asleep. He didn't appoint somebody directly, okay? He didn't want to, because that was wrong. He realized it was wrong. He couldn't do that. So he made it in a way that he would ensure that Imam Ali would never get elected. And that's what he's done. He elected 6 members of a panel. And he said, they will have the responsibility to choose one of them as the future Khalifa for the Muslims. And these names are Uthman ibn Affan, who end up winning. So would he vote for Imam Ali? Talha ibn Ubaidillah, he fought Imam Ali with Ma'rakat al-Jamal. Okay? Al-Zubair ibn al-Awwam, he also fight alongside with Talha against Imam Ali. Would he vote for Imam Ali? No. And Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, and we're going to come to that. And Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqas. They are all related. Uthman ibn Affan, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, and Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqas. The in-laws. So somebody, cousins and in-laws. Who will end up winning? And he put Imam Ali there. Of course, Imam Ali, nobody's gonna, because they all were, you know, so eager to get into the Khilafah. So it did not end up. And what he said, if they differ among them, they become like 3 against 3, go with a group that Abdul Rahman ibn Auf is there. Seriously, yeah. I don't need to elaborate on it more. It's very clear. If it's not directly appointing, it's indirectly. Go with the group of Abdul Rahman. Of course, it's pre-made already. Salaam alhamdulillah. And the sources for this is Ibn Mutahhar, Al-Bada' fi al-Tariqh, Al-Suyuti, Al-Khulafa. All of these are Sunni sources. Okay. So, Tariqh Al-Khulafa, Al-Suyuti, Tariqh Al-Yaqubi. When he appointed all of this, and he said, go with the group of Abdul Rahman ibn Auf. I need some light salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Okay, here is a very important question. Please, if you've been sleeping, it's time to wake up. Why the companions did not vote for Imam Ali? If he had all these exceptional characters, why? The Sunni will ask you this question. What's your answer? Why? Honestly, why? If you have somebody, he's brave. Nobody at his level of bravery. Nobody at his level of taqwa, of his knowledge. I don't know, akhlaq, you name it, I don't know. His, with everything, you tick all the boxes with him. Why? What's the reason? It's highlighted there in red for you, bolded. One word, jealousy. أقسم بالله العظيم. This is what I believe, and I'm willing to sacrifice my life for this. And I will prove it for you. A dialogue happened between Umar and between Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas is a cousin of the Prophet. Umar said to Ibn Abbas, do you know why what prevented your people from you? Meaning, prevented your people from Quraysh from voting for you, for Imam Ali, for your tribe. Okay? Why? He said, what? It was because Quraysh did not like to allow both prophethood and the Khilafah, the Caliphate, to be in your family. Both? You have both in the same family? Come on. It's too much for us to take on. Bani Hashim, they used to have, you know, Khadamat al-Kaaba, they used to be, the servants of Kaaba. And now it's too much over us, too much. Your family will go above our families within Quraysh. We can't let that happen. It's too much for you. You have a prophet, that's enough. Give us the Khilafah. That's in his words, okay? Narrated by Tafsir al-Tabari. by Tariq al-Tabari, so that you would become arrogant and rejoice amongst you will rejoice at it. Really? Is that your reason why you disobey Allah? Anyway, so that's the reason that he said. Umar continued. He said, Quraysh therefore preferred to choose a leader for themselves, and they made the right choice, and they were guided in that. فاختارت قريش لنفسها فوفقت وأصابت. That's his claim. And this is again mentioned in another source, شرح نهج البلاغة لابن أبي الحديد المعتزلي, a Sunni scholar. Again, there are many hadiths quoting a Sahaba saying, Ali ibn Abi Talib had many virtues. I wish if I had them. Some might say they said this out of love for Imam Ali. They want to praise him. But in reality, if you love someone, your action should follow. When the action doesn't follow, you don't love him. Okay? That shows you have jealousy. Umar said, I would give everything away that I have if I had those three things that Ali ibn Abi Talib have. Was given. What is it? The first, he was given Fatima as his wife. Salamullahi alayhi. صلى على محمد وآل محمد. And this upset many people. Okay, I have to move very fast. I'm sorry, I'm running out of time. Second, everything was made halal for the messenger, was made halal for Ali. And he was referring to the closing of all doors, you know, because the mosque of the Prophet, Masjid al-Rasul, used to have doors from all other houses leading into that mosque. In one time, they were all open, but by the command of Allah, he ordered all these doors to be closed except for one door, Imam Ali. This, you have no idea. Read the history. How much people were very upset with this. They got upset, they got jealous. Even yesterday, I just remembered something now. Yesterday, one of the people who came to, when Imam Ali said, من كنت مولاه فهذا علي مولاه, remember? They came down and he said to the Prophet, was this from you or from Allah? He goes, لا والله إنه فرق. قال إن كان هذا من الله اللهم أنزل علينا صاعقة من السماء أو ائتنا بعذاب أليم. He said, if this is really true from you, Allah, I want you to send a punishment on us right now. And he said, before he got into his naqa, a stone came from the sky and hit him and he died. This shows you how much animosity. Because Imam Ali was the best in everything. And then the third, on the day of Khaybar, oh, I need a lecture, full lecture just for that. A day of Khaybar, when night after night, they could not capture that heavy fortress of the Jews. Imam Ali, the Prophet says, لا أعطينا الراية غدا. Tomorrow I will give the flag to someone. Karrar ghair farrar. The word karrar means, you know, during the battlefield, sometimes you face the enemy, you fight, and sometimes you go back, you turn your back to the enemy because you want to get some help, or maybe you go to regather, you reposition. Imam Ali was karrar, meaning he does not turn his back to the enemy. He was just crushing through the lines of enemy, always going forward. Ghair farrar. يحبه الله ورسوله. Allah loves him and his messenger. ويحب الله ورسوله. وسيفتح الله على يده. Allah will grant him victory.
صلى على محمد وعلى محمد.
الله العظيم. My body is shaking. Time. I know. I'm sorry. Okay. So the next day, because Imam Ali was armed, he was sick. He could not see in his eyes. He was out of the picture. And they say, oh, the Sahaba, they all stayed all night waiting. Hopefully tomorrow the Prophet will pick me. Because the flag bearer back then, they give it only to the bravest men. Because you have to carry the flag. Because when you see the flag in the battlefield, that means you are still winning. People always look for the flag. And you have the flag in one hand and you fight the enemy with the other hand. You'll be the target for everything. Only the brave will take it. So during that Khaybar, Imam Ali, I have to go very quickly. He killed Marhab, who was the best leader there. They have the brave man. He killed and he opened the door of Khaybar with the help of Allah, obviously. And that was miraculous. Now, further evidence of envy, this is mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. You can go through it in more details. Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqas also said to Muawiyah, three things if I have similar to Imam Ali, I wish if I would, you know, be giving them and nothing else. One of them, he said, when the Prophet told Imam Ali, are you not pleased in that same position to me that you are to me like an Aaron to Moses, like a prophet? Second one, he said to him, tomorrow I will give the flag. We went through this. This shows you how much enmity that they had. And the third one is Ayatul Mubahala. And we touched upon this last night. When the Prophet called our sons and your sons and ourselves and yourselves, and he brought Imam Ali with him. One thing, we have to understand this, and it's Imam Ali, it's a fact. Imam Ali killed many, many of the Arabs, polytheists. And the way tribalism, remember? If you killed my father, I will never forget that to you. I will never vote for you. Even if my father was a kafir. قَتَلَ شُجْعَانَهُ. So they made him responsible personally for this. And that's why they did not. Because every time Imam Ali, during Ma'rakat al-Ahzab, when he killed Amr ibn Wid, when he says, Allah min Mubariz, is there anyone who's going to fight with me? And all the Muslims, they went like this. They don't want to, not even eye contact with the Prophet. And the Prophet says, who's going to fight him? And I will guarantee Jannah for you. And Amr ibn Wid, he was saying, don't you want to go to Jannah? Come on, I will send you to Jannah now. Only Imam Ali. Again, Imam Ali. Oh my God, they hate him. That's why. That's what happened. Sorry, I get so emotional. Okay, I'm just running out of time. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. إن شاء الله tomorrow will continue what happened after that. جزاكم الله خير.
أفلح من صلى على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
مصطفى في
إيكو. وعليكم السلام.
صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله. صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي وابن مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة يا ليتنا كنا معكم فنفوز فوزا عظيما. Tonight we remember the story of Muslim Ibn Aqil. A story of love, of loyalty, of sacrifice, of betrayal, of loneliness. Muslim ibn Aqil arrived in Kufa. He received the allegiance of thousands of Kufans. But soon the people started to abandon their promise to support Muslim and Imam al-Hussein. The same people who wrote letters to the Imam had now abandoned Muslim ibn Aqil. It's narrated that once Muslim enters the mosque in Kufa to lead Salat al-Maghrib, and after he finished Salat al-Isha, he looked behind him and no one was there. Muslim is now roaming the streets of Kufa all alone, with no one to guide him, no friend or helper to attend to his wounds. He didn't know where to go, so he sat outside a house, and an old lady by the name of Tawa, she came to ask him, "What are you doing here? Ma hajatuk?" Muslim says to her, "Iskhini shurbatan min al-ma." Can you give me some water, oh lady? I'm very thirsty. She asks him, "Don't you have a house? Don't you have a home to go to?" So Muslim replies to her, "Walakinni mali bil kufati manzilun." He replies, "I have nowhere to stay in Kufa." Muslim says to her, "وَإِنِّي غَرِيبٌ قَدْ خَذَلْنِي مَنْ كُنْتُ أَثِقُ بِهِ." "I am a stranger and I've been abandoned by those whom I trusted. Oh lady, would you show me some kindness?" She asks him, "Who are you?" He says, "أَنَا مُسْلِم إِبْن أَخِيل ابن أبي طالب." Tawa gave him refuge for the night, but she had a son. And when the son came home and noticed there was a man in his house that Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad la'natullah alayh was looking for, the next morning Ubaydullah sent 300 of his best men to the house of Tawa to get Muslim. And when Muslim heard the sound of the horses, he wore his armor, he put on his turban, and he got his sword ready. He said to himself, "Ya nafsi, akhruji lal maut." He says to himself, "Oh my soul, prepare to advance towards death." Imagine, this is Muslim. Thousands of people wrote letters to call Imam al-Hussein, and now he's left all alone, facing 300 men at the house of Tawa. He starts fighting bravely. The army finally captured him and took him to the palace of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. Muslim is injured, Muslim is wounded, and he begins to cry. So they ask, "Are you crying for yourself that you have been captured? Why are you crying, Muslim?" He replies, "Inni wallah ma li nafsi abki wala laha min al-qatli arthi. By Allah, I do not weep for myself, nor do I grieve over my death. So why are you crying then, Muslim?" He says, "Abki li Hussein wa Ali Hussein." Can you imagine the scene, brothers and sisters? Muslim is now crying for Imam Hussein. He says, I wait for Hussein and the family of Hussein. Why? Because they are coming to Kufa, and the same treachery that happened to me will now be faced by Hussein. They took Muslim to the palace of Ibn Ziyad. Muslim asked for some water. What is with the tragedy of Karbala and being thirsty at the time of death? They gave Muslim a cup of water, but as soon as he tried to drink it, the blood from his lip entered into the water and he couldn't drink the water. It must have been that Muslim had to see martyrdom with a thirsty lip, just like Imam al-Hussein, just like Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Ibn Ziyad then tells him, may Allah kill me. Look at him now, look at Ibn Ziyad. La'natullah alayh. He says, may Allah kill me if I do not kill you in a manner that no one before me has killed before. Ubaydullah then tells his guards, take Muslim up to the palace of the roof. Take him to the roof and cut his head off and throw his body down from the roof of the palace. Muslim is now on the roof of the palace. And he asked, I have a few requests. Can you fulfill them for me? So they asked him, what do you want to do, Muslim? What is your request? Muslim says, send a message to my master Al-Hussein and tell him not to come to Kufa. And then the enemy of Allah struck Muslim on his neck and chopped his head off, and they threw his body from the roof of the palace onto the ground. And then Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad sent the head of Muslim ibn Aqil and the head of Hani ibn Urwa to Yazid la'natullah alayhi in Sham. As-salamu ala gharib al-ghuraba. As-salamu ala شهيد الشهداء. السلام على قتيل الأدعياء. السلام على ساكن كربلاء. السلام على من بكته ملائكة السماء. ورحمة الله وبركاته يا حسين. ألا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد.